On today's video, we're gonna be doing a hydrostatic pressure test on the 60-gallon Ingersoll Rand tank using my pressure cleaner and a valve gauge up to 300 PSI, so stay tuned. Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. So I recently acquired this 60-gallon Ingersoll Rand air compressor from my office. We had a lab that they had this, and it's been abandoned for about 12 years. It was a 2003 model, and I haven't seen it used ever since I started working at the office. And since we're moving the offices, they were gonna get rid of it, so I decided to take it home and refurb it. I already upgraded all the valves. I put a coat of paint on here. This thing was sitting outside under a canopy for the last decade or more. Luckily for me, someone took the drain valve out of the bottom, so it was never pressurized and any water or moisture just flowed out of it, but it still did have some surface rust and some oxidation. I ended up buffing the tank, making it pretty clean. One thing I forgot to do when I had it all taken apart was actually do a hydro test on it. A hydrostatic test is where you fill it up with water and then you pressure test it up to 150% of the rated pressure of the tank. So one of the reasons why you always want to pressure test a tank, especially a tank that you don't know the history about, is that when it stores air, there's a lot of potential energy in that compressed air in here, and you don't want this tank rupturing or exploding or leaking on you when it's fully pressurized with air. You use water as a medium to do the hydro testing because water is not compressible. So what you do is you fill the water all the way up. Once you fill it up, it's mostly full of water as the volume, and then you fill it up with a little bit of air, and that little bit of air will build up pressure really fast. And if there is a leak or any kind of catastrophic failure of the tank, that water won't explode and it won't have much potential energy. The most you'll do is spring a huge leak, but it won't kill you and it won't hurt you. So that's why you do a hydrostatic test. When I got this thing, I didn't even know about it until I started doing some more research, and I found out how easy it was to do a hydrostatic test at home. So that's why we're doing it today. As far as the PSI you wanna test up to, a lot of people test it to like a 1.2. If you really wanna be safe, you could go up to a 1.5. This tank operates up to 175 PSI. On today's test, I'm gonna jack it up to about 260, 265. Once I get it up there, I'm gonna let it sit for a couple hours to see how well it holds the pressure, if there's any leaks or anything. So here's the 300 PSI gauge where the pressure regulator goes. I'm putting it right here for this experiment. I still have my check valve right there, which I just recently replaced, and I thread locked everything back together, so I don't want to take it apart. It's also a good chance for me to test that out since it's rated for 500 PSI. This right here is a half inch service valve, and this is where I'm going to end up putting the pressure washer on and filling it from here to get my pressure up. I ended up putting a nipple that's designed for a pressure hose nozzle because it's a little bit different than your normal air nipple. As part of the tank refurb, I ended up putting this remote drain line right here that goes into the middle so I can drain it from the side with the little ball valve right there. Other than that, the rest of the refurb of this was replacing the two run and start capacitors on the motor, changing the filter out here, and just cleaning everything up and giving it a nice coat of paint. The belt was still pretty good, so I kept the original belt that's on here. If that thing eventually breaks, I'll end up having to replace that. Before I put this in service, I plan to put an after cooler on here using that derail oil cooler that everybody uses. That's gonna be my next project on this once I get this testing done. So right now, I've got my pressure washer set up. I've got the hose wand and everything connected to that nipple. This thing's closed right now. Once I turn on the water pressure, this thing should pressurize up to whatever the house water pressure is. And then I gotta start this thing up to actually get some pressure into here. Fill it up with water. I'm gonna just fill it up until I don't hear it spinning anymore. And then we'll see what the pressure is before I start it up. So that quick burst actually got this thing over the 300 PSI mark on the thing. So I'm gonna relieve a little bit of pressure and see if I get it down just to make sure that we don't over pressurize it too much. So I unscrewed that thing off of there. I'm gonna release the That took it down for a little bit. And so it's 270 now, so we'll leave it at 270, lock it there, and then take this off. So see, we got the pressure down to 270. I'll let it sit here for a couple hours and see if it drops any. Once it passes that test, we go ahead and drain the water out of here and call it a day. So I let this baby sit for about 6 hours now, and it's dark outside and it hasn't lost a single PSI. It's up at 270 where I left it off. So I'm gonna go ahead and relieve the pressure now and just empty this tank. You can see right now why you use water as a medium to test this, because water doesn't compress. So the only pressure in there is a small amount of air pressure that's got the air pocket. So once you release it, that's all the drop that you're gonna get. That's basically it. Now it's free flowing, and then it's just gravity letting it drip. Drop down to no pressure in the tank right here while it's dripping. Thanks for joining me on this quick video on how to do the hydrostatic testing on this tank. As you can see, it's a pretty straightforward process using that pressure cleaner. Other people use different methods. I think there's a method where you could use a grease gun, where you pump the grease gun into the fitting onto here and pump it up to get the same pressure. Plumbers have a special hand tool they also pump also to test lines when they do actual plumbing work. But for my case, since I didn't have either of those tools, the pressure cleaner was the next best thing, and it's readily available and easy to use. So if you found this video useful, give it a thumbs up. If you haven't subscribed to my channel already for all my different DIY videos around the house, in the car, or in the garage, go ahead and subscribe to your channel. I try to keep up with all my DIY videos every time I do something. For all these different projects, if I can do it, you guys can do it too. So I want to thank you for watching, and I'll talk to you guys next time.